Hi everyone, really great to be here. As you can hear, I've got some horrible lurgy affecting my throat, so I very much hope that you can hear me okay. These are my disclosures because I will briefly be talking about the technology we've developed for early detection of esophageal cancer. So, esophageal cancer, what's the motivation for my study and my team study of esophageal cancer? This is a horrible, poor outcome cancer with less than 20% 5-year survival, even now with all our advances in chemotherapy and molecular targeted agents. But we have a real opportunity to understand the evolution of this cancer and to intervene very early. And so the vision that has been really driving our research is how could we come up with a new paradigm where we proactively test people at risk and in a way that doesn't require endoscopy, because that's the current gold standard diagnostic method, to find those at high risk for esophageal adenocarcinoma who we can focus on compared to those at low risk. Now, in the early detection field, there's only really purpose in detecting people early if you've got a really good intervention to offer at an early stage to cure the disease. And in the esophagus, we're very fortunate in that we have excellent endoscopic therapies. So if the lesion is early, stage T1 tumor, if superficial, you can resect it endoscopically. You can use a burning technique called radiofrequency ablation, and you can cure these patients and completely transform their outcomes. No chemotherapy, no esophagectomy, which is what we see for those on a curative pathway. So detection early is absolutely the key to transforming outcomes for these patients. Now, from a research point of view, the esophagus is also very accessible, and our patients at risk with the precursor condition Barrett's esophagus, which I'll introduce you to in a moment, they attend over multiple times over their life course once they're diagnosed. And we take samples over space and then temporally. So this provides an excellent vehicle to really understand the evolution of cancer from the earliest stages. So this is the Barrett's metaplasia condition. So your normal esophagus is lined by a striated squamous epithelium. And in patients with the risk factors, which are older age and reflux of acid and bile, that stratified squamous epithelium is replaced in the distal esophagus by this metaplastic lined epithelium. And if you look, this is the endoscopic view. So this dark red appearance here, that's the Barrett esophagus. So it has transformed from the normal pale squamous epithelium to this columnar lined epithelium. So it's a dramatic transformation. And this epithelium is really looks under the light microscope like a mosaic of gastric and intestinal cell types. I can tell that this piece of tissue came from the true esophagus because this is a submucosal esophageal gland duct. So this isn't a piece of stomach tissue. This is taken from the lower esophagus. And it looks a bit, has gastric cell types in it, specialized cell types, but it also has these goblet cells, which are pathognomonic for this Barrett condition. And we call this intestinal metaplasia. So it has an intestinal and a gastric phenotype. Now, the majority of patients with this condition, although it increases the risk, they won't progress to cancer. But a proportion of them, about 0.3% per annum, will progress through to dysplasia and adenocarcinoma. And because this is such a devastating disease, we intervene at this point of dysplasia. So this is the evolutionary trajectory that we're interested in. So the questions I want to discuss is, first of all, I'm telling you Barrett's is important, but is it actually the obligate precursor to esophageal adenocarcinoma? Do we know that? What evidence do we have that Barrett's really underlies all esophageal cancer? How can we risk stratify? What does the genomic landscape tell us? Are there molecular predictors we can use for progression? And how can we actually use this in a clinical setting? So the reason that I think we should pause and just ask ourselves, is Barrett's metaplasia really the obligate precursor lesion, is that the patients, when they present with their adenocarcinoma, 90% of the time, they have no idea that they had a precursor condition. They just present with their cancer. And then when they present with their cancer at that time, if you look carefully endoscopically and at the pathological specimen and at biopsies, about half of the time, you can't see any evidence of Barrett's esophagus. Even if you're looking histopathologically for any evidence of intestinal metaplasia, you can't find it. So it may be that the tumor has overgrown the precursor lesion by the time you've diagnosed it, Or maybe there are two independent pathways to developing the cancer. Now, this to me is very important because if I'm developing screening and early detection strategies to find Barrett's, I better be sure that that is usually the gateway. Otherwise, I'm kind of shining the torch in the wrong place. The other thing we noticed is that when you can identify the Barrett's esophagus adjacent to the adenocarcinoma, the prognosis of the patients is better. So this just goes to, this is an example of a tumor where we can clearly identify this large adjacent epithelium, which is all the precursor Barrett's esophagus in this small tumor. Here it's rather harder to tell. This is at the junction, is there any Barrett's there or not? So just want to give you two pieces of evidence which I suggest that suggests to me that Barrett's is the precursor. The first is some mathematical modeling done by Kit Curtis and her group at UC San Diego. And what Kit has done is to develop a mathematical model where she takes the scenario that yes, Barrett's is the starting point, and then we take the known transition as best we can for Barrett's transforming to premalignant dysplastic Barrett's all the way through to cancer, and then map that onto the US SEER data for the incidence of esophageal adenocarcinoma. And basically, the SEER incidence data exactly maps onto her model, which assumes that Barrett's is the starting point for all esophageal adenocarcinoma. The other data has come out of a single cell sequencing, RNA sequencing study, which was designed to address two questions. The first is to identify the cell of origin of Barrett's esophagus, which has actually been very controversial and unclear in the field, with different theories from that it might arise from submucosal gland ducts that I showed you in the earlier picture, or that it might arise from embryonic stem cells residual in the junction, or that it may arise from the gastric cardia. So we did single cell transcriptomic profiling of all of these putative cells of origin to then compare that with the Barrett's esophagus and then also do lineage tracing using several different methods. And that all suggested that the gastric cardia is the cell of origin for Barrett's esophagus. What we were also able to do then is to take that single cell transcriptomic data and map it on to the transcriptomic profile of esophageal cancer and take cancers which do have Barrett's esophagus associated with them, the EAC plus, and those that don't have any evidence of Barrett's esophagus. And basically, it's the RNA transcriptomic profiles are indistinguishable compared to whether there is Barrett's associated with the cancer or not. And this is particularly relevant for the undifferentiated markers compared to the differentiated markers, suggesting that the trajectory is the same, basically. It doesn't matter whether you can visualize the Barrett's esophagus anymore, but transcriptionally, it's similar. So to the best of our knowledge, it does seem that this Barrett's epithelium is a very important precancerous state. And so this is the model that we arose at from all these data, putting together the single cell transcriptomics, the lineage tracing, which I haven't got time to show you today, and then looking at the carcinoma to suggest that it's the normal gastric undifferentiated epithelial cells which undergo transcriptional reprogramming. And here c-MYC and HNF4-alpha are critical transcription factors. And that can then lead in a proportion of cases to esophageal adenocarcinoma. And so the question that really arises, you know, what is the trigger here for the malignant transformation, given that most cases of Barrett's won't transform to cancer? So that's the question we've really been trying to unpick for some time to understand who will progress and who won't. Now, this is a study, Jamie Weaver's in the audience here, and this was a study we did almost a decade ago now. And the results from this study were really surprising. So what the question I was interested in is, what are the key driver gene mutations which determine progression from non-dysplastic Barrett's through to dysplasia and adenocarcinoma? And I thought we'd see a nice kind of stepwise progression and some tipping points that we could, you know, really potentially use this as a early detection tool to identify people at risk. But life is never so simple. So for the design of this study, we took patients with non-dysplastic Barrett's that we had long-term follow-up out to 10 years, and we knew that they stayed indolent. And then we compared their profile with patients with high-grade dysplasia and patients with adenocarcinoma. Now, we've known for a long time that P53 is an important trigger for this disease. And indeed, the P53 is informative. In other words, The nevodysplastic Barrett's didn't have any alteration in their p53, whereas by the time you get high-grade dysplasia or adenocarcinoma, you do have a loss of your p53 and mutation-driven change. But if you look at these other genes, and the tail goes on much longer, what was really surprising to us was that even in the indolent nevodysplastic Barrett's, you have mutations in these bona fide driver genes. Now, I guess we've got more used to this concept now with all the studies being done on normal aging tissues, and really understand that, you know, in our normal healthy epithelium, we're collecting these mutations, including in bona fide driver genes. If you think of the work of Inigo Martina-Carena and Phil Jones and so on, looking at normal squamous esophagus, for example, we've become more familiar with this. But in the Barrett's epithelium, even the nevodysplastic, it's really hard to pick out what the discriminators are for progression. So with such heterogeneity, you need large scale studies to really try and drill down on what's going on. And so we set up this multi-center UK-wide collaboration to really enable us to have the opportunity to drill down into exactly what's going on. So this now has over 4,000 patients in this study, and we have whole genome sequencing on over 1,000, and this is what used to for the International Cancer Genome Consortium Atlas. And in a proportion of these, we also have RNA-seq and methylation array data as well. So this is the driver gene landscape as we reported it in over 500 cases back around 4 years ago, done by Alex Frankel leading on this work. And so again, we see p53 dominating. And again, we find that it is indeed very heterogeneous. In this study, we could update our driver gene tools. And so we could really unpick, and we coupled this with RNA sequencing wherever possible, we could really start to distinguish the passenger mutations from what seemed to be the bona fide driver mutations. So you can see that you have to watch out, because a lot of the mutations which you might think are doing something actually turn out to be passengers when you look carefully. And we also started to see that amplifications are clearly important. Some of the more prevalent changes, including high level amplification from extra chromosomal DNA alterations. Now, that analysis didn't take account of the structural variants, which are also very abundant in this cancer type. And when you start to take into account the structural variants, so this includes large-scale deletions, tandem duplications, BFB events, and so on, then you do start to see an increase in prevalence of many of these genes that we're interested in. So the CDKN2A alterations in this cancer goes up from 25 to 43% of cases, and so on. So adding in the structural variants certainly gives us an idea of what may be most important. And it also identifies some new drivers. Now, it's interesting to us that 22% of the complex SVs were breakage bridge fusion events, or ecDNA. And it's hard to deconvolute these events, as you'll know from short read sequencing data. So in this latest iteration, we were using long read sequencing using Oxford Nanopore technology combined with the methylation profile to perform de novo assembly and to really try and disentangle the ecDNA events from the breakage fusion events. And indeed, these can be different within the same gene. So as you can see here for KRAS, for example, there's more of a predominance of the BFB, whereas in the ERBB2, it's more ecDNA. And then we derived a number of organoid lines from these patients, and that enabled us to understand what's happening to these events over the evolutionary time course through passaging these organoids. Because one of the fascinating things about ecDNA, of course, is that they're decoupled from the normal mitotic spindle of replication, so you get this stochastic inheritance. And we found that there is selection for these organoids that harbor ecDNA events using single cell DNA sequencing. So let's go back, that's all in the cancer setting. Let's go back and think then what's happening evolutionarily as we go from the Barrett's to the primary tumor through to the metastasis. So here we put all of the data together across these different stages of disease, almost 1,000 genomes, and looked at the mutational processes, which is quite helpful when we've got such a heterogeneous disease to try and really understand the etiopathogenesis. So this was de novo signature construction. which show that there are 14 signatures really active in this tumor type. And the most abundant by far is this SBS17 signature, which is laid down really early in premalignant Barrett's esophagus. Now, some of you may know that this signature is also triggered by 5-FU and capecitabine chemotherapy, but Barrett's esophagus obviously isn't treated with any chemotherapy. A proportion of the primary tumors are, but in our cohort, we tend to focus more on the chemo-naive samples and get them prior to any chemotherapy. So, and it's indistinguishable when it's induced by the capecitabine, but here this is truly de novo SBS17 early in the evolution of the disease. We also see APABEC to some degree, and basic scission repair SBS30, which interestingly was the most prognostic of all the signatures. So this was correlated with a poor outcome. And DDR signatures are also quite abundant through a variety of different mechanisms. So the purpose of this wasn't really to use signatures to distinguish the stage of disease, but actually it does work fairly well. So if you use the signature information to generate a random, use a random forest model or a gradient boost model, you can actually distinguish between the premalignant Barrett's and the primary cancer pretty well with an area under the curve of about 0.86. And in this figure here, what it shows is the output from the gradient boost model for Barrett's esophagus compared to primary tumors. Each dot here is a different patient, and they're in rank order of their importance for distinguishing these two disease stages. And the higher the enrichment of that given signature, the more purple the color. So APABEC and the aging signatures are really predominant in the primary tumors, SBS17A and B in the Barrett's esophagus, and the clonality turns out to be very important. So these SBS17 signatures are clonal in the premalignant Barrett's, and then you get more subclonality later on as the disease progresses through to metastases. And then looking at which genes are most relevant in these different signature types, we see SMAD4 and KRAS is important in the primary tumor. P53 is common to the Barrett's and the primary tumor, and so on. So this is just depicting it really another way, showing you the signatures laid out in rows here for the Barrett's esophagus and the primary tumors. I haven't included the metastasis, the sample size is quite a bit smaller. But you can see again that the SBS17 signature really dominates. And this is associated with P53 alterations and MDM2 preservation and keeping with what we'd expect from that pathway. And CDK6 is also associated. And this leads to a when you have more than 5% enrichment, leads to an increased proliferation. So I think this is telling us something quite important about what might be driving this carcinogenic process. So P53 crops up time and again, and we know that the copy number really becomes disordered as you go through to cancer. So in this study, what we did here was we took advantage of the longitudinal data that we had, and we compared patients who were indolent, non-progressors over many years, and compared their copy number data to progressors, to high-grade dysplasia and cancer. So you can immediately see that the non-progressors have far less going on compared to the progressors. This is P16 here, CDKN2A. You can see in the progressors, P53 is what really seems to trigger the genomic instability. And this is an early event in Barrett's esophagus progressing to high-grade dysplasia carcinoma. And this is new data that's just been published from Matthew Stackler's lab at UCSF. And I think this is really fascinating insight because it seems that losing the second allele of P53 is important. I'm showing that data here. But then you start to get these early changes in copy numbers, and you can start to look at the haplotype by using this haplotype specific analysis. What they observed is that you actually see this sloping copy number change before you get the clonal expansion and the traditional sort of classical step change that you see here. This is the homolog. So this is not a technical error or something. The homolog is you know, useful in that regard. And here you can see this is a high-grade dysplastic lesion, an intramucosal carcinoma at three different loci. And you see this copy, this sort of sloping copy number, where in multiple generations, you're getting incomplete replication of this broken chromosome end. And it's exactly the same locus. It's clonally expanded in the cancer in these two cases here, not so much in this one. So this gives us an idea of the what's happening early on as this get this P53, and this is always coupled to P53, these P53 copy number changes which occur through multiple generations are then clonally expanded. And we also see these P53 triggered ecDNA events, again, always linked to loss of P53. And you can get multiple ecDNA events in the same patient. So this is a study we did jointly with Paul Michel in Stanford, and took advantage of cohorts like this, where you have patients sampled over multiple levels of their Barrett's esophagus and repeatedly over time, and can build these phylogenies showing that here we've got one ecDNA event at the point at which dysplasia happens and a second one later on. And then, of course, one can understand exactly what's incorporated in these ecDNAs that may be important in terms of the pathogenesis of the disease. And so this is just a summary showing that actually 31% of patients where we found ecDNA actually had multiple ecDNA events. And these are the genes that were incorporated and likely to be important. So a lot of accumulating knowledge, which, if I can summarize, really shows this is a very heterogeneous disease in terms of the driver gene landscape. P53 biallelic loss is very important as a trigger for chromosomal instability, and perhaps we can use this as a diagnostic tool. And Barrett's is the gatekeeper, as far as we can tell. So most Barrett's is undiagnosed. So how can we find it in the at-risk population, which are older people with reflux, without endoscoping everyone? And how can we then have a good idea of not worrying people unnecessarily, given that most of them won't progress to cancer, of really understanding who is at risk and intervening early compared to those that have really a trajectory for indolent disease? So you can't endoscope everyone at risk. So what we did some years ago now is develop a really simple tool for non-endoscopic cell collection. And this is a useful research tool as well, because you get a very abundant cell collection using this tool. So this can be done in an office setting. I always have one in my bag if anyone wants to try one afterwards. But you just swallow this little pill. It's attached to a thread. The pill will dissolve over about 7 minutes, and out pops this sponge, which you then literally pull out and retrieve a very rich panesophageal sample. So this is easy, inexpensive, operator independent, and then you can do whatever test you like on the cells that you've retrieved. So this is an example of how it works. So a little cartoon. So here you are swallowing the capsule tethered to the thread, and then you just wait 7 minutes, out pops the sponge, and now you're going to pull it out. You'll take cells from the gastric cardia and then all the way along the esophagus. And we use the gastric cardia cells as a quality control. We know it's gone all the way down. And then we have this panesophageal sample, which is about 1 to 4 million cells that we retrieve. Now, one thing you might say is this really a representative sample? So when you do an endoscopy for Barrett's, you basically take four biopsies every 2 centimeters. So there's potentially a lot of sampling bias. And there's some horrific statistics in a lot of analysis recently in the clinical world looking at why we're so bad at doing well in diagnosing this cancer. And about up to 10 to 30% of patients with an esophageal cancer diagnosis actually had an endoscopy in the last 12 months, but no one found the early lesion. It's horrendous. So with the sponge, how good are we? How representative are the cells that we collect in really representing the architecture and the clonal heterogeneity of this disease? So this is the traditional kind of samples that I hope that was champagne. this is the pathologist sort of workload from all those biopsy samples taken at endoscopy. But this is the kind of cell, if you look at it morphologically, this is the kind of yield you get from the cytosponge. But does it really represent the clonal architecture? So this was an experiment we did just to really ask the question, to demonstrate to ourselves that we were recapitulating the clonal architecture. So this was a patient who'd had an endoscopy that had dysplastic disease, and they had 27 biopsies taken over the length of Barrett's. They had a long segment of Barrett's. And we did whole genome sequencing of these areas shown in white here. And then we developed a panel of 1,400 odd variants for targeted resequencing. And that enabled us to basically work out the clonal architecture of their segments. And then we took those same targeted resequencing panel and applied it to one single sample from the cytosponge compared to the 27 biopsies taken at endoscopy. And basically, we could recapitulate the exact same clonal architecture. So of course, no method is perfect. You may miss things, but we get a pretty good sample from this technique. So we've been working to generate the evidence to see whether this is a useful diagnostic tool for Barrett's esophagus. And this is what the EGRN expect for phase of development of biomarkers to get them into the clinic, going right from preclinical exploratory through to cancer control. This is the evidence we've been accruing. I won't bore you with the details, but including a case control study to look at the accuracy. And then we went on to do a randomized controlled trial of screening versus usual care. So that's family practice, usual care with people with reflux to see if we would diagnose more cases of Barrett's esophagus. So these studies, as soon as you get into screening, you have to do huge studies. So this was over 13,000 patients, which were randomized. And so the outcome measure we were interested in is, do we diagnose more cases of Barrett's esophagus or not? So the rate ratio for diagnosing Barrett's was 10.2 when they were offered the cytosponge compared to normal care. In other words, we found 10 times more Barrett's when they were offered this test. So this data was intentioned to treat based on the offer of a test. So we included even those that didn't take up the offer that were just in the intervention arm. 13% of patients tested positive on this test. These were people all with reflux. And the positive predictive value of finding Barrett's and dysplasia and stage one carcinoma was 59%. So as I showed you on that EDRN thing, what ultimately you need for screening is to show whether you have cancer control. In other words, do you reduce mortality from your test? Because when we got the results of this trial, I went to the National Screening Committee and said, we're really excited about this. Do you think we could roll this out as a national screening test? And they said, well, you've shown you can diagnose more cases of Barrett's. You haven't shown whether that actually does the patient any good. Have you reduced morbidity and mortality from your test, which is the million-dollar question in screening? So we're about to do that trial. It's a randomized controlled trial. This gets huge. 140,000 patients will be randomized 2-to-1, 2 to the usual care, 1 to the cytosponge, and to see if we can reduce morbidity. In other words, we won't have to have chemotherapy and esophagectomy because we diagnosed them earlier, and mortality from this trial. And these are all people at risk on medication for heartburn. We invited by a text message. And at the same time, we'll be able to collect a biobank, which should be great for research, which will be open for people to apply to access these specimens. So pretty excited about that. And in the last few minutes, it's fine. You can diagnose Barrett's with the cytosponge, but what you really want to know, as I said, is, you know, distinguish the indolent from the progressors, and how can we really use all this information that we've been learning about the pathogenesis and evolution of this cancer to really inform that question. So, there's a lot going on in these cancers, but what we do know is, don't forget the phenotypic signal that you get. I mean, it's hard to interpret dysplasia, it's quite subjective, but if you do have a readout of the phenotype, that can be very useful. P53 is clearly important. So we're not just interested in a mutation in the normal healthy tissue, but loss of the P53, and then measuring the genomic instability. And what we see, we're not trying to replace endoscopy, what we see cytosponge potentially, this kind of technology is a real way of triaging patients so that we only endoscope those that need it most. So this is quite a simplified study in a way. So we were just using two markers because we wanted something we could actually do in clinical practice today. And this was really accelerated because of COVID, because endoscopy was locked down during COVID. And I had a call from the Scottish government saying, we're really going to be stuck. Do you think you can use cytosponge to take people off endoscopy waiting lists, including those waiting for their Barrett surveillance? So I had to take our research and move pretty fast to something we could put in the clinic. And the sequencing just wasn't ready. So what we did was to implement P53, and the protein expression is a really useful tool. It gets rid of the stuff which is not so important, just a single copy mutation. And also we use the Atypia, and that enabled us in this 891 patients, which then led to the NHS implementation during COVID to divide patients in low, moderate, and high risk, in which the high risk group are the ones that have Atypia P53. These are clinically more at risk. And then we could time their surveillance accordingly. And what's really interesting is we find stuff on the cytosponge here. These patients had P53 and Atypia that really looks very classical that the endoscopist didn't find. So then we bring these patients back and keep an eye on them because this may be true disease. But what about the progression with the copy number? Because really, we need to add the copy number to our assays. And this was a study that we did using shallow whole genome sequencing to make it cost effective and to get a whole genome readout of the copy number profile, in which we again took this design where we took patients that we had multiple time points and spatial representation, patients with long follow-up who'd progressed compared to those that didn't progress. And what we were really interested in doing is saying early on, prior to their progression, prior to them having any dysplasia, can we already detect copy number changes in these patients? So this is just a mountain plot where we've just overlaid all the data from all the patients, comparing the progressors to the non-progressors. And you can immediately see quite there's a stark contrast here with the chromosomal instability in the progressors. And if you map each patient, this is what it looks like. So each of these little plots is looking over space across the esophagus and in time. These are the progressors and these are the non-progressors, and we've used a logistic regression algorithm to make a threshold for abnormal or normal in their copy number. And you can see that there's a lot of abnormal copy number shown in red here in the progressors compared to blue in the non-progressors, but there is a little bit of heterogeneity within the segment of a given patient. And then you wonder about people like this here, and maybe they will progress, but they haven't done so far. And the copy number algorithm really predicts risk way in advance of dysplasia. So this is 8 years prior to their dysplasia. And in 47% of patients, we could already see an abnormal copy number signal. And this was a validation curve cohort to see how well this copy number algorithm performed for predicting people in advance that they would go on and get dysplasia. So what we really want to do is to think about how we could apply these kind of algorithms into clinical samples as a diagnostic test. But obviously the bar for doing that is somewhat high and something we're still working on. This is an alternative approach for detecting aneuploidy here, not from a non-endoscopic cytosponge, but from an endoscopic brush. And this is using a single primer pair to look at repetitive DNA regions. This is called RealSeq. And they are able to then drill down on specific chromosomal losses. In our algorithm, we were really looking genome-wide. We didn't worry too much about where the signal was coming from. But again, they were able to distinguish patients with dysplasia from those without. This was really more prevalent disease rather than in advance. So to summarize, I hope I've convinced you that I think Barrett's esophagus is a very important condition in terms of being a precursor lesion for esophageal adenocarcinoma. And we have several different lines of evidence for that. And I think the signature 17 also suggests that this is an important obligate precursor as well. I think it is possible to risk stratify Barrett's esophagus using molecular signatures, which will ultimately be much better from the pathologist looking down a microscope for dysplasia. And I think the signatures, loss of P53 and genomic instability could all help us out there. And if we can apply those to a non-endoscopic tool, then I think that could really potentially alter our, you know, the way that we identify these people. Because if we just wait for them to be referred for an endoscopy by the time they've got symptoms, then we're onto a losing wicket. So I should thank all of the fantastic lab members, past and present, who've contributed to this work. And I've tried to acknowledge some of the key players as I've gone along, and funding, particularly from the Medical Research Council, Cancer Research UK. And thank you all very much for your attention.